Fever can make things wonderful. The sicker I become, the more clearly I can see that everything is connected by light.
In Mark Helprin's novel, light is a character. And light fundamentally doesn't seem to actually have an inherent value of good or evil. People kind of use it for good or evil.
Winter's Tale is an epic tale of romance and magic. And we get to discover that lurking underneath the world and the city of New York are the forces of good and evil.
No matter how far we tip the scales our way, no matter how many of them we turn dark, nothing seems to break their capacity for hope.
For me, it's a story of good and evil, you know, which I think fairy tales are uniquely suited to do.
In Peter Lake's real world, he is an individual who fell into the wrong gang, but the innate goodness in him has caused him to drift apart. And he unexpectedly, and perhaps for the first time in his life, finds true love. Now, outside the story of Peter Lake in the world he doesn't quite see are the forces of good and evil, and the evil forces wish to prevent him from fulfilling his destiny.
I need to stop this one now!
Pearlie isn't human, so, you know, I suppose he's the personification of evil, and no matter what it seems that we do as humans to try and reach a better balance in our lives and stuff, there's always that element of evil that exists.
Here's the thing about Colin, which you gotta give to Colin. Colin has good chemistry. Like, a lot of people have good chemistry with some people. Colin has promiscuous chemistry. I don't mean he's promiscuous as a person, but his chemistry is available to yours. If you're good, he's gonna meet you.
Working with Colin, it's been so special because finding those moments of lightness and happiness in the most inopportune times almost has been fantastic.
Jessica, it's divine working with her. You know, she's got such a lovely big heart and she's incredibly sweet and funny. And she's telling herself she's very goofy and she's lovely. She's just really open, which is the beautiful thing.
Jessie is if she's floating in the air in front of you. It's very special. She's got something unique.
Shooting with Russell, I mean, it was brilliant because I literally met him on the set when we were about to film the scene. So there wasn't much acting involved for me. There was this creepy calmness to the way he sort of dominated that scene. And, you know, that felt terrifying. It felt far more, you know, scary. He just sort of almost escorts her down, but in a way that she can't let go. He's got her. And it was amazing.
You know, Russell is one of the great actors of our time. He really is. And what he does is he transforms, which, of course, then makes him transformative. And that makes you relate to him on screen in a different and unique way. You know, you can see what he is to the movie. It's like it anchors it in darkness.
That one, Romeo, that red-haired girl. You got me, all right? The one right there. See it, that one. Okay, that's the one. The one who is his destiny.
Russell and Colin, you know, their fight at the end. You know, I remember we were rehearsing. We had a half day of rehearsal, not even, before we started shooting it. And I looked at them at one point and I was like, you guys are not the same as me. I would clearly be in the hospital, but their fight sequence was like a dance for them. And the way dancers can learn steps very quickly and then execute them as if they've known them their whole lives, these two men could do that with their fists. And that was pretty awesome.
But also, we were doing a lot of fighting stuff and it was great fun, but the scenes were really intense and kind of emotional and he's just a wonderfully detailed and concise actor, but within that concision, of course, he's really open to changing and moving in the scenes, and yeah, it's been an absolute blast.
I had a great time working with Colin. He was very focused and worked quite hard on the physical stuff. Yeah, I mean, he did give me a couple of decent whacks in the neck at one point, but he was quite apologetic.
We're very fortunate to have a fantastic cast because Akiva himself is a magnet for that kind of talent. Many of whom have worked with him previously as a producer and screenwriter.
I didn't write it to direct, but when it was written, I suddenly thought, oh, I actually have to direct this. And then I called in every favor I've ever had.
I got involved because Akiva and I have been friends for many years, so I've been hearing about it for years. So when it all finally came together, I was so proud of him and excited that he wanted me to be a part of it.
I'd worked with Akiva a long time ago. I was glad to get this chance.
We're friends first and, you know, filmmaking collaborators second, really. So, you know, every day starts with that. You're lucky enough to be involved in a really cool project with one of your mates. So it's a very positive thing.
No, not like that. We have him now. Let's do it slowly.
In the movie, there's Athensor, who is referred to in Mark Helprin's novel as the white dog, and he's a white horse. And he is, I think for those of us who read the book, one of the things that captured our imagination so profoundly. He is beautiful, regal, you know, he loves Peter. There's something about Peter that promises to be important in his ability to fulfill destiny, and this horse, this angel, comes down to help him.
You don't quit me. I've been blackening souls and crushing miracles for longer than I can remember.
You know, I'm not a horse person, turns out, but I love that horse, you know, and his doubles, of which we had quite a few.
We got four white horses that play the main horse in the movie, but every time you see Colin, it's Listo. His name's Nova Listo. I bought him out of Oregon. And this horse has kind of become a character. He's got where he's, there's a scene where he pushes out of the barn. Well, after three takes, Listo decides, hey, I know this. And he'd shove the doors open before they were ready. He knows the word action now, and he can be a little bit of a smart aleck at times on camera.
You know, he's a very special animal. He was smart and kind, and I started to understand why people get so attached to horses.
Listo, the horse that Colin rides. Rex spends thousands and thousands of hours training, 4 or 5 hours a day for 8 weeks, and then while we were shooting, still working with him. He loves it. Well, look at his ears. He's so happy. He's very proud of himself. That was better. That was very, very good.
Really wonderful trainers. Carrie just, I think, literally, like, speaks horse. She and the animals have a kind of amazing bond.
Let's see how he'll pin his ears, and you know, he gets into character. He knows he has to fight. Now he's turning him off, his ears go up, and he looks to Rex for reward, and that means he did a good job.
Colin loved Listo, and Listo loved Colin, and you know, they started to work together the way any pair of actors work together. And sometimes Listo would want the light. It was lovely. Colin is a horseman, as is Russell, so the scenes with the horses were very natural to them.
He just likes a good fight.
Pearly Soames, I've no idea what you're talking about, but I know one thing. I'll tell it to you on the next take.
I'd try any horse, do you know what I mean? I wouldn't be technically adept or anything and posting this trot thing. But the horse is magic though. He's been so cool to ride. He really has been very cool to work with.
Are you all right?
Perfect.
Good.
Winter's Tale is an attempt to reconcile what appears to be very mundane day to day with a larger cosmic order. I told the story out of my own hope that everything happens for a reason.
What the story suggests is that there is bad things in the world, but the good side, the sense of hope, is ultimately triumphant. And that is due in large part to the human spirit.
No life is more important than another. And nothing has been without purpose. What if we are all part of a great pattern that we may someday understand?